Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm going to show you how to do MLOps with MLflow. As you probably know, if you are following my channel, I'm doing a series of videos about this tool, about MLflow. And today I will show you how to set up a MLflow infrastructure to keep track of your experiments and your artifacts, models, and had this infrastructure ready to be used in a production environment. I will implement all these components in a Docker as Dockers in a with Docker Compose, and this way we will be able to deploy this into a production environment. So, what is MLflow? Probably you. If you are following the channel, I already upload a couple of videos how to do training and fine-tuning of the LLMs with MLflow. You can check on the channel these videos. And today what we are going to do is just set up the infrastructure and test it and show you the different scenarios and possibilities you have to set up this infrastructure. Our focus is doing something that is repeatable, that you can and use in a production environment of a company or in any industry, and to support the job that either machine learning engineers, data engineers, or data scientists are doing on their daily activities. So what is MLflow? Well, it's a tool, it's a set of tools that help you to keep track of what you are doing during the machine learning life cycle. This any phase in the machine learning life cycle, like the exploratory analysis, where usually data scientists are involved, or the experimentation, where probably you collaborate in that phase with the machine learning engineers, thinking how you are going to deploy this, the models that you are building and the application that you need to build to serve these predictions that are going to do this model, and also and later on the inference phase and serving predictions to the user and monitoring and governance of the whole. No? So for that we had a tool like MLflow, which help us in all the phases that we had in the machine learning life cycle. There is similar tools on the market. I will explain you later on Qflops. This is probably the embryon or the seed of all of them, and after that, after Qflops, most of the people, most of the fabricants follow what the approach that these guys were doing, and one of them is this MLflow. MLflow, as you probably know, is integrated with plenty of the libraries. You can check in the documentation. They are fully integrated with most of the big fabricants or names on the industry: OpenAI, AWS, Machine Learning, Hugging Face. You can see here. You can see as well deep learning libraries. Probably you are really familiar with all of them, and also with traditional ML. Exibus. So all these libraries that you see here are fully integrated with MLflow. You can track models, you can do inference, you can train models, fine-tune, whatever you think you are able to do with this is fully integrated and have the same interface to do any activity that you plan to do with them. So meaning that you can, the same way that you train an XGBoost, if you are training a Prophet model, is the same interface, the same commands, the same API, and this for any model that you had present here in any of these categories. So, sorry, deep learning, as I said, TensorFlow, Python, Keras, Spacy, and LLMs. Everything is having a single interface, which obviously, when you are working with a Python model, had some specific parameters just for Python, case that and also another specific parameters for Spacy. But when you say, for example, load the model or save the model is exactly the same method. It's a class specialized in a spaceship, but is doing heritage from a general class which define the main components of this functionality. So you also can use different languages. You can use Python, R, Java, and also use a conventional REST API like the one that you use for many other tools with a simple HTTP request. Okay, today we are going to set up the MLflow tracking server. Essentially, you have these components. It's the API. This API I mentioned you before. It's a standard API. You can access the tool via a simple HTTP request. A backend store where you keep all the metadata that you generate with your experiments in any phase that you are working on, and meaning that the parameters that you use for training, the name of the experiments, the outputs, and also very important, the location of the files, for example, that you log, because at the end you, for example, serialize or set a model in MLflow server or in the MLflow model storage, and then on this finally is a storage in a location, in a physical location, and then on all this information is saved on the backend store as metadata. Then on you have an artifact store where you are persisting, physically persist the artifacts. It's not archive in the backend store, it's archived in a physical location, and this physical location can be either a file system or a blob storage or Amazon S3 bucket. And then you can save here again models, tables, plots that you draw in your ML pipeline, like a correlation plot or whatever you are doing. Everything that physically how to say you want to serialize to keep track of what you did on that experiment is saved in the artifact store. I will explain you later how it looks like and how to clean. So the backend store can at the end is saving all this metadata. It can be saved in file system as well, in another location different to the artifact store, but file system at the end this is files, or in a database that can be either Postgres, Microsoft SQL, MariaDB, or SQLite. This small database, SQL database that come with the Python library. So you had the tracking server optional that essentially provides you a REST API to access all the either the storage, the artifact store, and the backend store. Today, the common scenarios you have here in the documentation, there is the simple ones for you working at home or you working on your own. You can have everything on the single in the same machine, or more than in the same machine. The simple installation is have everything on the local disk. At the end, I think let me show you flow. Sorry, I have it this on the. Let me 1 second. I will find out. I had this on my Debian. Let me show you Debian. I'm working with Windows or System Linux, and I had everything on on a MLflow and runs, and then you can see here this is the experiments, and everything here is save it on the disk. This is in this configuration I'm going to show you today. This is only the artifact store, but if you decide to have as well the backend store, it will be something similar to what you see here. In another folder, here they are the ML runs. You have here the experiments, and in the experiments, inside the run ID, you will have a pair of artifacts, other folders with the content or your metadata. You will have metrics, you will have other folders that contains the all the metadata and pointers to the files that you had in the folder artifacts to later on easily localize and be able to localize and to retrieve models or plots or tables. For example, your training dataset and your test dataset, it's not they are very big, you can keep it there as well if you have space. At the end of the day, it's a file system and it will depend how much gigabytes you have there, and then you will be able to log data up to the file system is full. In any case, you can also use a file server or mounting the file a share of the file server into your local machine and log the data there, or as mentioned the documentation, you can use a cloud storage, S3 or Azure Blob Storage. This is only to keep again the metadata. But the in a production environment, usually you use a professional database or a database which gives you the possibility to grow and to get access to different users at the same time. So you can use as well in your local environment a database, this SQLite3, which comes with Python 3. But this database had the problem that not is very limited in terms of performance, and well, for a local environment is fine, but if you plan to do this how to say in a company, you need to move to another database like MSQL Server or Postgres or MariaDB or MySQL. Today we are going to work with MariaDB and you will see how we install it and run it in a Docker service and also the PHP admin tool to manage the database. Okay, that's all. So today we are going to do this scenario 3. With something slightly different, instead to have a cloud storage, we will have a share mounting the a share in a local folder in Windows System Linux, and it's something similar to this. In any case, in a second video I'm planning to do, we will see how to mount this into a cloud storage. You need obviously to have an account in Amazon or in Azure to do that, and we will do it in that case. But the scenario is the three. We have a database, we have a tracking server, you can access multiple people can access to the tracking server, and instead to have cloud storage, we will have a file system, something on the file system with this pointing to a share in the or can point to a share in a file server, in a whatever. The only thing that you need is to have access and to run the MLflow tracking server with a user who had write permissions, write and delete permissions into that folder. The same apply to the cloud storage. You need to have permissions to write, to read, to delete in that specific location. Okay, other requirements you need to do this exercise, you need to have Docker. In my case, the host is a Windows. In my case, I have Docker desktop. You need to have. I'm working the project in itself is gonna run in Linux, in Windows or System Linux. So you need to have your Docker integrated with your backend Linux to be able to run Docker, create the Docker components and access the Docker engine from your Windows System Linux, and then you need to have this integrated. In my case, I'm going to use Debian, so you need to have this. You need to have Windows System Linux installed. As well, you need Conda. Anaconda. I create a Conda environment in Windows System Linux. Let me show you here. I create an environment. I'm creating here as well. Later I will upload to the repository, as I usually do, all the information with the the software and all the files that you need. And in the documentation, I will point you out to everything that you need to know to run this experiment or this this project at home. So I create an MLflow server, sorry, an MLflow environment, and then in this environment, I simply, probably we can even on the list, I think, we can see here what I install. Essentially, I install Scikit-learn, Jupyter, NumPy, Pandas, MLflow, and PyMySQL. And well, in next videos, I will talk how to fine tuning, training models, sentence transformers, LLMs, everything. We will need additional libraries, but for today, you just need minimally this, and later, if you want to run the experiment with the client, here I'm going to log the activity of training a random forest regressor and some activity on the MLflow. If you want to run this as well, you need Jupyter and Scikit-learn and Pandas, the only thing that you need for that. Okay, so let's start. Basically, what I'm doing here is creating a Docker Compose. This Docker Compose is a configuration file to create Dockers in your infrastructure, in your Docker infrastructure. If you are familiar with that, it's pretty simple. It's not, I will explain you what we are doing here. So you will need by the way, you need Git as well, Git. You need to have it installed as well, because MLflow is looking to your Git information to record it as well on your MLflow experiments. If you don't have it, if nothing happens, because it's gonna work as well, but it's better do this correctly. No, usually you work in a repository, you keep your software there, and later we will be extending this for other purposes, for other including additional additional software, additional functions to do many other things, and then usually what you do is to create a repository with GitHub, GitLab, whatever tool that you are using, and then you keep the changes and you track the changes in the repository. So if you want to do it, I recommend you to do it like that, and then keep everything that as you will see here in a repository that you have created in any of the repository providers that we have available. So you will need for that a Docker Compose and that end environment, and then you have here other files that I will explain you later on in this process. So the first one that you need is the service, the Docker Compose files. We are going to create three components. One is the database, the MySQL server. We use a MariaDB. We use a PHP MyAdmin tool, which allow us to manage the database. This also, we take the Docker version. Here we take the version 10.3. We can use another, it's not really an issue. Let me check which one is the latest one. MariaDB. Okay. So last, we had the 11.4, so we can update it in any case. It's not gonna be an issue. But yeah, in this installation, we need to check as well in Docker Hub, what is the latest image that they have available. I left this to you just if you want to change it. The process is going to be the same. No problem with that. So we have three components, as I said: MySQL, PHP, MyAdmin, and MLflow. This is the tracking server itself, no? We also had a volume to persist the database on secrets that we will use for the tracking server and for the access into the database. And we had a network which creates a virtual networking environment for the three components that we are deploying here. So what we have here: the image name, container name, host name, an environment file where we keep all the secrets and all the variables that we use for the deployment. Everything that you see here with a dollar in between brackets is a variable that you have that you keep here. You have here the databases. This is going to be used on the environment inside of the Docker. This is these pointers to the secrets that we define here. And you have the port. This is the exposed port of these Dockers. This is the admin port and the database port of the database. And we have the volume, the persistent volume, where we will keep all the information of our database and the connection to the network inside the Docker infrastructure. PHP admin, something similar. And MLflow, we are using a Docker file to build the MLflow. We will look it at then now. The image, the name of the image, the container name, the host name. This is how we are going to call the name, the Docker inside the network. Depends, the depends is obviously the attributes is explanatory itself. It depends on MySQL. This means that it is a component fails when you are building the Docker container. These two cannot continue. Environment files, port exposed in this case 500. Here we expose the 80 into the PHP admin port, which is 8080. Take a look later to the secrets. I will post the secrets because, well, this is you can keep the secrets as you want. Change it if you want to deploy this on another environment. Later, we have here something important. This is we are mapping a folder in the host that is running or keeping the Docker infrastructure. In this case, it's my Windows system Linux, and then I'm mapping this folder in my Windows system Linux to this folder inside the Docker. You can see that there is the same name. This is because I'm running the Docker with the user AllAnon in that case, no? And I'm creating as well a home directory inside the Docker, and I map this to the Docker. I will show you now when I describe what we have on the Docker. And finally, the network. This is the volume. It's just pointing to the location where you are going to persist the data for the artifact store, no? And then this can be this folder locally can be whatever. So if you use a file system, obviously. If you use an S3 bucket, the reference is a little bit different. So you need to, where is this? Yeah, you need to do this. To plan it differently. You don't need to do this mapping. In that case, you just need to create the artifact, the full artifact route with the S3 bucket name and the full artifact destination also with S3. With Azure is something similar. Instead to do S3 is ADSL as head of the URI. But in this case, as I said, I'm mapping everything to the local file system, and this again, in this local file system, you can have it can be a share, a mapping share in your Windows system Linux to a file server or whatever you want. Okay, now let's move to the Docker file. The Docker file is using an image with Python 3.11. So we are installing the upgrading the system and installing PIP. With this, we remove what we don't need from the after the update. Then we create a group, the name Emberflow and a user all or not, and we add it to the group Emberflow. We create an variable environment which contain the path. We create the environmental variable path inside the Docker and contains this path, which is the home of the user that we just created, that local slash bin that path. And we will install everything under the home directory of the user. Why we do that? Because if you don't specify we are specifying here that this Docker is going to run under the Olonok identity. Why we do that? Because you shouldn't run any server in a production environment under root, because you know that is a security problem with that. And then in this case, what we are doing is just running it with a user which had without root permissions. And then to do it that way, we are installing everything, all the software. We are installing the Emberflow software. We are installing in under the home directory of the user. Okay? And then we copy the file to the working directory. We install the requirements file, which essentially contains just two packages, Emberflow and PyMySQL. We create the ML runs and we provide access to that to the home directories inside the Docker to everybody. We say that this Docker is going to run under the identity Olonok. We expose the 5000 port. That is the port where that we will use to access the Emberflow server, and we run the server with this command. Emberflow server backend story is, you have it here in environment, in that case backend store is the access to the MariaDB. You access to another database, it may change here the reference and the port. So the key is here, we are referencing to a MySQL and the port 3306, that is the port that where is listening the database to access the data. And we have as well the data for the full artifact root, which is as well the full artifact root. Here is the file system I mentioned you before. So it's in home all or not ML rules. You can check here. The same that we are saying here. That's why we create this. And don't forget that this is mapped to my local folder in here. I will show you later how it looks like. And sorry. We have artifact destination. This is the default destination. Once you need to log something, where is gonna log it? In the here is you can specify other, but usually you specify the slash the root. And you have the host, no service artifacts. So this means that the artifacts are gonna be serviced through the tracking server. The host, we put 0.0.0.0 to use any IP address available in this container. In this container, it's gonna be only one, but you can have this in a multi IP address server, and then specify this. You are saying that any you expose the port 5000 to any of the IP address available on the server. Okay, so now I will show you here. So let's go to my home. So here I need home Olonok. We make Emberflow. We enter in Ember runs. You can see here we had experiment 1 and experiment 3. And I have here this already running, but I will show you how to build the Docker container. We can enter in the Emberflow tracker. This is the server. You can enter to the Docker itself in the exit tag. And then on you can see here, yes, I'm inside with the user. I'm inside also home all or not Emberflow runs. This is pointing, as you can see, to my server. So we can do a ps hyphen ef. You are going to print all the processes running on the server. We can do cat this file. You can see here, this is this content, and now we are, as you can see, on the Docker, but you now go to here, we are in the ml runs. You see we had the experiment 1 and 3 and also the file we just created. If you do cat ps.txt. So you can have this, again, now it's in the file server, but this, again, can be a shared in a file server. The only thing that you need is have permissions to write, delete, and read an execution in that folder. Okay, and then once you have this created, the only thing that you need to do is you go to something additional. Sorry, I forgot. I recommend you, if you are using VS Code, to install the Docker plugin. You just can go here to the extensions and find Docker. Docker. And then on you have it here, that one. You install it in your Docker container, and this gives you access to your Docker infrastructure in your local machine. And then you can connect here to the registries, Docker hardware, Azure, generic registry, whatever. Okay, but having this installed, you just simply can come to the Docker Compose and right button and compose up. And if you do it as well with the Docker file, you can simply go there and build the image directly on your Docker desktop or in the Microsoft Azure directly. You have the registry connected here. Okay, let's build this here. You will see, just do an app and then it's trying to, there is no changes essentially. We can do a change, simply when you see that, you will see that it's creating the three containers. One is the Emberflow MySQL, the other one the tracker, and the PSP admin. Once it's finished, let's change here something that you see. But for example, we are going to install pandas as well. I don't know, NumPy in the Docker in order just to force to reveal the this Docker itself. You just click here as well, and you will see now that now it's gonna use again. Now it's detecting that there is the file changes. You are familiar with Emberflow, you know that if there is no changes, that reducing all the layers of your Dockers, and it's clever enough to understand what changed on the Docker. Here they realize that they change some requirements, some files on the, or some components on the requirements file, and it's going to run the process after that, no? From that, so it detecting that this is changed here, so everything that that happened before is just reuse it for the previous build, and from that moment it start to update the Docker itself. Okay, it's installing now. It's gonna take some minutes. Let me make a pause and we continue. Well, now it finished it, the requirements, is continuing, now exporting the layers, and now you can see here on the containers, Rebuild, refresh this volumes. Yeah, here is just, you can see here that is rebuilding this, and then on, it will be a point where it will remove that and replace it with the new setup. So here you can see here is recreating, and then at some point it will replace the container. Okay, it's finished. Now we can check on the Docker container what's going on. Now probably it's starting, it's already start, and you can execute bash here to get a bash shell. You can run Python import pandas as pd and pd that version to just check what you had. We install as well, I forgot requirements, NumPy as well. Okay, so let's leave, well, let's check as well import MLflow. We can check which version of MLflow we have here on the Docker. Oh, sorry, I misspelled here. Version 2.12.2. I think it's the latest one, so we are fine. Okay, you have here as well the database, MySQL. Yeah, here is, yeah, it's a ping when you try to access the tracking server was being replaced, and here you had the PSP admin. So you will get something like this in your Docker desktop. And now you can also check this here. Images, all the images I had on my setup, and you can. I have it here. Customer classifier. You had the tracker. You can connect to the tracker as well here. Inspect. Attach feature, attach cell, and you can hear, you are here as well inside the Docker. We can remove this file, and essentially we are removing the file from now let's kill the Docker sheet. And then simply we return here, and you can see that the file is gone. Okay, now what more? Now we are going to test our infrastructure here. So I create this notebook that later I will post you. Is just a simple experiment, doesn't matter exactly what I'm doing. I'm just again training a random forest regressor and saving the model into the model registry, and let's check here another version 2. I will give another name, version, to you see what's going on. We are going to just in case, and restart the kernel, because before I record this video in Spanish as well, and then, well, I'm just reusing the everything I explain in Spanish. I use the same notebook and the same installation. But okay, that's it, matter. So here we just import MFlow, some stuff from scikit-learn and pandas, just to create a data frame to later serialize to MFlow. So what you got is this MFlow, your MFlow server. Let's refresh. We have here, this is two tests I did before. You will have a UI without these two. You will have only the default and everything empty. This is the experiments I did before. You will have your PHP MySQL admin listening the port 8080. The passwords to access, you have it here in that M. You had the database name, the ports, and the users to access. Using PHP MyAdmin. So this is the database is created during the installation process. When you install MFlow, when you run first time MFlow, it's gonna detect that you are pointing to a database, and then it will create all this infrastructure, this database, and all these tables that you see here. The tables essentially contains the metadata. You can see here the pointer to the location where the artifacts are. You can check, for example, metrics, probably nothing, input tags, you can see here. Many of these stats automatically generated by MFlow because of the autolock function. We will talk about that in the next video, how it's working with different technologies MFlow. And well, you have here all the metadata that you produce in your experiments. Runs, metrics is there, yes, you have metrics. Very important always, the run ID. The run ID is what links the information across all these tables. So the run ID, you can check here in an experiment, is the identification of the run. So you have two levels. It's a top-down speaking. It's first of all, you have the experiment. We have two experiments, experiment one, experiment three. This is how it works. And inside the experiments, you have runs. Every run can be different. You just nominate here, I don't know, model, fraud model, or NLP model, whatever you want, and then you have here pues, different versions, different tests, usually what the data scientists are doing, or what we are doing during the modeling phase is we are experimenting with different approaches, different parameters, different blah blah blah, and then everything is tracking here. You track not only the parameters, you can make notes, you can write tags as well to identify, you can make a description as well and describe what you did here, is saving the date of the experiment, here metrics of the automatically done, you can do your own metrics as well, you can log your own metrics, you can, and also artifacts, everything that autolog generate on also what you generate yourself and log to the server. You have models here, the models that you are logging. This is the experiments I did up to now with the same version. Now we will do another one. And here again, okay. And having this later, you can retrieve the model. You can take a look to the model itself. MFlow name data, no schema, exactly. This is we didn't provide this during the process. We will talk about this in the next video. The video of today is just to deploy the infrastructure to later on test with other components. here you have this model is registered. You can see here, this is you can see here that we have two models that are the same. One is generated for the auto lock functionality, the other one is the one I'm logging here with this sentence. Okay, I'm registering the model to the experiment, and also when you introduce the register underscore model underscore name, you register the model as well in the model repository. Here I also log in an artifact, which is essentially the a file I'm creating here with the predictions. So what you need to access to run an experiment I'm using here the Python SDK. You can use as well Java, R, or just simply the HTTP REST API. But here I'm using Python, and then you need to set the tracking URI in Python. In this case, it's gonna be this component where you are pointing to the tracking server is, 5000, localhost 5000. This can be any URL. You may have this in your local network with another host name, and then you create an experiment. We are going to create now the experiment 3, and then what we are doing here, we create the experiment. It doesn't exist, and it is exist. We just set the MLflow experiment to the name that we write in this variable. So we run this, and now, okay, it works. We should have here an experiment 3. Empty, obviously, because we didn't do still anything. So now we are going, when you encapsulate this with MLflow start run as run. So run component is going to capture all the activity, activity metadata in this object that later you can use for other purposes. And here we just simply disabling autolog case that the version of MLflow is not compatible with this specific technology library, in this case random forest regressor. It is not compatible because you may have an old client and it's not compatible with the version of the MLflow that you are installing. You just simply disable autolog, and then on you will be logging only in this experiment where you actively log with log artifact, log metric, log model, or whatever. And it's not autolog is active. In this case, the version is compatible, and then we just fit the model and do some predictions. This doesn't really matter. We will look at the other technologies in next videos with OpenAI, Python, and TensorFlow with transformers, sentence transformers, and also prompt engineering. Okay, we run the cell. It's gonna take some seconds. Okay, and now we have created version 1 of the new model. Let's go here. You see here that we have a new experiment. You can go here and you see here everything that was automatically locked, because this, as again, this algorithm is compatible with MLflow. This is what automatically log, and this is the artifacts we log. Here, the model itself is what autolog automatically log, and also this estimator HTML, and also you can check here that this gives you the possibility to register the model, but we did it already as we use the register model underscore name parameter when we log the model. Check to look to this sentence, MLflow flavor scalen log model. What MLflow, as I mentioned you before, is providing you a common interface for all the technologies that the MLflow integrate, and You will have one for HCBoost, one for PyTorch, one for TensorFlow, one for Transformers, etcétera, etcétera. But all of them will have a log model, a save model, a load model to load the model from the repository. The only thing that will change is there is a specific parameter that apply to the flavor that you are using to train your model, no? In case that you had again a deep learning library, a sentence transformers, a whatever you are using. And here, the saving the artifact, the data frame to predictions. That is that you can see here, prediction dash CSV. How this looks like? Let's take a look to the. We had the experiment. 5C ending in 60. We can take a look here. Sorry, this is my machine. We are going to Linux. Debian Home or another framework runs. Now we had the folder 4 and the experiment here. Artifacts, and you will see exactly the same that you see on the screen here. Exactly the same. And now we can take a look here. So you go to experiments. You see here the experiment 4 is test 3 is pointing to this folder. And you can go to runs as well. And you see here where we can see exactly is the MLflow overview. 5C60, that one, and you can see here, I don't know if we can scroll a little bit here, yeah. Exactly, we can move it there, and now probably we can extend it a little bit more. No, but okay, you see here, you had the description where is located the artifacts of that run. Location, experiment number 4, and this is the run ID artifacts. If we go to the file system, run ID artifacts, and you have the model. All the metadata is saved on the database, and the database is serialized. We have here a permanent volume. You can take a look. This is the permanent volume, that one. And the file system, the artifact itself, the storage, is a folder in my local host. And as I mentioned you before, this host can be shared. It can be a share of a file system or whatever. You can use some tools as well available in Linux and also in Windows to even map a S3 bucket or a Google bucket. I don't remember the name, but let me 1 second. Yeah, I didn't find what, but well, there is plenty of tools that you can use to mount in packets of any flavor. As you can see, the Google Drive, whatever, in your local machine, also S3, whatever. There is many. You can take a look yourself. I forgot the one I used some months ago, but yeah. In any case, there is plenty of technologies that you can use for Windows, Linux, Mac. If you want to map as well a cloud bucket in your machine. So, okay. Okay, that's all. That's all for today. I didn't want to do more than 1 hour, but in any case, thank you for watching the video. I hope you find it interesting and useful for your work or for your training. And as I usually say, subscribe to the channel. If you didn't do it before, give me a like and promote the channel with sharing the content or with other colleagues or friends, just to help me to to promote and expand the channel in YouTube. Thank you very much. See you soon. Bye bye.